And welcome back. Well, our next guests are psychotherapists who notice some common threads about women who have ADHD that they've often been filled with shame and hiding.
We are happy to welcome Dr. Michelle Dewar-Frank and Sari Solden. They wrote this new workbook. It is called A Radical Guide for Women with ADHD. They hope to empower these women to lead fulfilling lives. Good morning to you both.
Nice to be here.
Thanks for being here.
Thank you.
During the commercial break, I asked you if either one of you have ADHD. You both said
yes.
Both of you do. Yeah. When was it discovered in your own life?
I figured it out in my 40s, you know.
Luckily. Late in life.
Late in life. Relatively late in life.
It's discovered in children. Yeah. How about for you, Doctor?
You know, for me, it was something that kind of assumed. It runs in my family. And it was like, well, you have ADHD, yeah, but you do really well in school. So it can't possibly be a problem until it really became a problem in other ways. Later on, and then I thought what a lot of women with ADHD think, which is I need to try harder to mm-hmm. shore up my deficiencies and fix this, and I need to go it alone and try harder, and I ran myself into the ground in graduate school, and that's when I finally said, okay, maybe I do need to deal with this in a different way.
I want you to kind of define it because, you know, I think, like, I told you during the break, too, we joke, a lot of my friends, oh, we have adult onset ADHD, we can't finish a book, can't focus, whatever. I think, what people immediately kind of think of, but what are the true symptoms? What does it mean to have ADHD?
So ADHD is a brain-based difference. It's highly genetic, and it impacts self-regulation and what are called executive functioning skills. So, you know, the deficit part of the name it's really a misnomer because it's more of an inconsistency or a dysregulation. Sometimes people with ADHD actually can hyperfocus and pay attention too well. For instance, like organizing the sock drawer when you should be leaving the house in the morning.
I get that.
It's an inconsistency. It's not about knowing what to do, but doing it. And some of these executive functioning skills are things like getting going, staying going over time with a goal in mind, putting on the brakes. And it also impacts things like memory, emotional regulation, organizing your behavior over time. But what research is showing and what we've found, and Sari has known over the course of her career, is that people with ADHD struggle just as much with those symptoms as they do with a deep sense of shame and not being good enough in the world. And that once we help them work through that and untangle that and develop a stronger sense of self, that's when the ADHD changes actually start to happen. That's when they're able to reach out to those supports and have those strategies work effectively.
It's heartbreaking to think of people carrying this shame, especially because, and not only because, it's something you can't control. It's something that happens to you, that you just have. It's not something that you've created. Right.
Exactly, and that's what the process we describe in the book is, we call untangling, because this is why women have shame. They grew up without knowing that they have this difficulty because they were inattentive. They didn't meet that stereotype that you read about hyperactive, trouble-causing boys. So they grew up not understanding why they were okay in some areas, and some areas they're having such tremendous difficulties and comparing themselves to other women. And so that's why we describe this process of untangling, to help people separate out their brain-based difficulties, that are not their fault, from their core sense of self and self-worth. Because when women come in to see us as psychotherapists, that's what they're all tangled up with. And and the process, why we wrote this book and why it's different, why we called it radical, is with the radical but simple idea that instead of trying to fix yourself or have the shame about who you are, you could just simply learn to accept yourself. And I think what is radical is that we don't just talk about strategies and tips and medication, which are all really important, but that's been an overemphasis in the field. And we are trying to change the conversation as therapists to show, okay, but then you have to also, while that's happening, don't wait for your life to become fulfilling or meaningful. Give yourself permission to go out and be who you are and develop your talents.
Yeah. What were some of the symptoms you were experiencing in your 40s that led you to find your own diagnosis?
Oh, well, it was my whole life. I had severe problems with organization, even though, like Michelle said, and this is why people don't, you know, catch it. We're smart, we're doing well
in
school.
You're a psychotherapist.
But it's life. It's life is much more difficult than school, for instance. So once women, that's when they sometimes get diagnosed, after they go to college or they're living on their own or they're getting married, at some point they can't keep up with the demands organizationally, and that's when they crash. So I've just been searching for it for a long time, and I finally found myself working in an agency where I could find these answers.
So what's the difference then, hearing that, between someone who's taking on too much and can't, and trying to multitask just too many things, which often women do, being a mother and working and a partner, versus an actual diagnosable
problem? Right, that's a great question. I'll let Michelle, but it's severe and chronic is what I want to say. It's not just everybody reacts like this under stress.
You know, when you drop the things, are you still in the same spot? Mm-hmm. I think that's a huge indicator, and people with ADHD will tell you that even the most basic things are hard. In fact, the harder things are easy, and the easy things are hard, and it's not about being able to do a lot. It's about being able to keep up with more basic tasks of daily living consistently over time. And it's a largely internal experience, and that's what a lot of people don't recognize, that it's not necessarily these hyperactive behaviors or, you know, talking too much or being ditzy. It's a deeply felt experience. And I think, you know, so if people without ADHD are really struggling in our society right now with our glorification of busy, when you do have these challenges that make it hard to do some of these basic things, it exponentially increases. And then they feel like their value is less than.
Yes, because I can't accomplish things.
Mm-hmm. You guys have an event tonight where people can meet you, pick up the workbook, learn a lot more about
this. So many questions,
because,
right?
Yeah, especially your point that women typically are diagnosed later in life. It's fascinating. Again, the book event is tonight. It's at 7 p.m. at Boswell Book Company, which is located on Downer. You can go to ADHDRadicalGuide.com to learn more about the book and about you two ladies. Wonderful to meet you.
Thank you. It's a pleasure.
Thanks for sharing your time with us.
Thank you.
Yeah.